kiss the Blarney Stone, drink tequila in Mexico, skydive, hang glide.
Got a rainbow.
Riding number one.
He's about to come out here in a few minutes.
Okay.
Get in shape, learn to sign.
Good, buddy.
This is Coach Wright's vehicle here.
Before I say goodbye. Give a fake name at Starbucks. Make love a mile up. Watch the northern lights dance in the sky. Road trip to the west coast. Tour Napa, sip Merlot. Send a message in a bottle with the tide. Stand up,
oh, yeah,
fight for my...
Hey, Coach Wright, how you doing?
I'm Tom Sylvester.
Yes, sir.
I just thought I'd say hi.
I see you're in town. You want to come in?
No, I'm not.
Chase my fears off a cliff, dreaming of...
Coach, you got to come in for a few minutes.
Hey,
Jay. Hey, Tom, how you doing?
Good to see you. Great to see you.
Hi, Mr. Mayo, how you doing?
Jay,
long time.
Yeah, James.
Yeah.
In this life, there are no do-overs. So every chance that I get, I'll be trying to find my four-leaf clover. I wanna live big. Forget about what ifs, chase my fears off the cliff.
Therefore, I, James W. Sanders, mayor of the city of Blytheville, Arkansas, do hereby proclaim July the 15th, 2016, as Coach Larry Wright Appreciation Day.
We honor him. So we rise up tonight and we bless Coach Wright. And we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
For the land of the free and the home of the brave. In Mexico, skydive, hang glide, save a life.
This is your film, Coach Wright.
When I think about this project that we're doing, it takes me back to when I started here at Blytheville High School under Coach Wright. My parents set me on a solid foundation, but what Coach Wright did was gave me all the directions.
When you can get the boys to the proper state of mind, sir, you've got a winner. You've got a winner. Whenever I think of that, I think of a game down in Champaign not so long ago, year we won a championship. I can always think of that Wisconsin team as long as I have a nice young team here come along. Not very big. The opponents outweighed us this afternoon, 121 pounds to a man. I had a young linebacker named Boyle. Now, don't get me wrong. When I give you my stories of these things, these few things, facts I'm going to bring before you, you've got them too. In your universities, and in your life, and your coaching experience. And you know how far 1 yard is? 36 inches? 3 feet? The longest darn thing in the world when you got a defensive and the shortest darn thing, the longest darn thing when you're trying to get it? 1 yard. Johnny Cota took his Wisconsin team back in the huddle. And as Johnny was about to enter the huddle, this kid Borio of mine, 187-pound, I repeat, that fullback, linebacker of mine, holler for Johnny, "Hey, Johnny, send Amici at me. Send Amici at me," he said.
Well, about 1969-70, we decided we wanted a football team. We've been losing. I must not say anything bad about the former coaches, but we wanted to get AD, and we had a school board member with us, Mac Williams.
Blyville was in a rut.
And so we brought Mac in. We said, "Mac, we need to do something," and Mac agreed.
Back in the 70s, I was on the school board, here at Blyville. And I played football when I was in high school. And I enjoyed the sport, and I wanted my son to follow me.
So we decided to do, to approach the school board about hiring an AD and him hiring a coach for us. We knew the one we wanted, Bill Mayo. And Bill Mayo was a good man.
Bill Mayo was in Blyville one Saturday morning, and
L.D. Harris had called me and wanted me to come to Blyville and talk to him. So he wanted me to look at the athletic program and if I could make any kind of recommendations or anything. And I said, well, I haven't been involved in that situation in 10 years. He said, well, come and look at it and tell me what you think.
So finally, Mac prevailed upon him to hire an AD, and we hired Bill Mayo.
At the Division Street where that Exxon was, I was getting some gasoline, and Bill Bracey pulled up. He said, do you know anybody looking for a coaching job? I said, no, I don't know anybody offhand, but I know some pretty good coaches.
A friend of mine talked to me at the Dixie Pig here in Blyville on a Saturday morning. He said, Mac, we've got to do something to find a coach and get our football program back together. And Blyville, for years and years, had a wonderful football team. Back in the 40s and 50s and 60s, and it just fell apart.
We had a meeting with Mac Williams and L.D. Harris, and Mr. Harris really pushing for this guy, and Mac Williams told him, says, well, if he's gonna come and be athletic director, he's gonna be in charge of the athletic program. And said, if this athletic program is not successful, the next person is going to get fired here as superintendent. And so they told me, if I wanted to hire Larry Wright, go get him.
I'm going to ask you to go with me and visit with him.
So I went to Memphis and talked to Larry at 2:30 in the morning. I told him really what needed to be changed for the football program has changed the culture.
Now Bill, when he came in, he said, I'm gonna bring in a guy named Larry Wright from Memphis. He said, I don't know whether y'all can stand him or not, he said, but he's a good coach.
I said, well, there's only one man that I know of that can make it a winner. He said, who is that? And I said, Larry Wright. But I said, I don't think you guys are tough enough to handle him.
The first time I met Larry Wright was at the track meet in 1970 at in Little Rock. He walked in there. When he walked in, he had on a black shirt and a white tie, and I thought he'd just come out of Chicago Mafia. I didn't know. I tell you what, he looked tough. And I think some of the boys could explain that to you, too. And he was like that kind of.
Well, I'll never forget the first day that we met him. We were sitting in the health classroom in the boys' gym.
Well, you know, I remember the first time I met Coach Wright. He came in the spring of 71. And I guess he was meeting with the junior high guys that was coming up the next year. And I remember I was East Junior High, and he walked in the door and walked across the court. And looking at him, black hair, black shirt, black tie, black coat, black everything, I'm like, wow.
The first thing that I noticed was his car pull up in the parking lot. And so I see a guy get out, and he's wearing all black. He's got big white polka dots on his shirt. I see him fiddling with his hair. He's messing with his belt, and he's kind of walking like John Wayne. So I really didn't know what to think. I thought, well, is that our guy? And apparently it was our guy, but I didn't know who it was. First, I thought it was Johnny Cash in all black. Next, I thought it was John Wayne by the way he's walking. And I knew once he came around the other side of the car and I saw those white patent leather shoes, Elvis had come from Memphis.
And he got in there talking about, if you want to win, this is where you need to be. You come over here and we're going to do all this. You got to make a commitment to winning. You got to dedicate yourself. And that struck me, you know, I didn't really know what I was getting into.
He walked in, never seen a coach wearing a suit before in my life. And we're going, okay, what is this? He walked in, he said, first year, I'm going to run off the people that don't need to be here. Second year, we're going to win a couple of games, but we're going to lose a bunch of close ones. And he said, the third year, we're going to go undefeated. And he turned around and walked out of the room. And we all just sat there and kind of stared at each other like, okay, what was that?
So we're all in a group, and Coach Wright comes over, and he's still fiddling with his hair and messing with his belt and stuff. And when he starts talking to us, he said, if you will invest in us, we're going to invest in you. It's going to take a lot of hard work. And if you do what we ask you to do, by the time you graduate, you'll be conference champions. And that really struck me as a 16-year-old kid, that somebody could come in and make that type of promise. But you know, when you dress like Johnny Cash and you walk like Elvis, you know there's something special. And you got, you know, and Coach Wright had a swag about him. And every one of the players, and I think that you'll find this through talking to the players, that we took on some of the persona of Coach Wright, the swag he had, not necessarily the swag, but the confidence that he had.
You had to fight hard to win, because if you want to win in life, you have to fight hard. Losing and laughing about it, well, that wasn't a game.
When I was in the ninth grade, Bible was 0-10. And Coach Wright came in to East Junior High when I was in the ninth grade and said, if y'all stick with me for 3 years, y'all be playing in the state playoffs.
Our first season was a total disaster because we were totally unprepared. We had some great athletes, but a lot of them weren't willing to make the sacrifices, literally, of participating with Coach Wright's leadership. The seniors on my sophomore team, that would be Joe T. Robinson.
We were 1-9, and I can't tell you who we beat. You saw that he knew what he was doing, and he was beginning to teach us, but we had just so many bad habits.
She said, sit down, Marcus. He says, yes, sir. She says, let me ask you something, Marcus. How loyal, how dedicated are you to Chickasaw football? I said, well, sir, I'm dedicated as they can be. I want to play football. I want to win. I love football. I love this town. I love this school. He said, well, let me tell you why I'm asking, because we're getting ready to start a conditioning and strength training program unlike you've ever known, unlike anybody's ever known in this town, in this program. And it's going to be tough, and you're going to want to quit. And there'll be a lot of people that do quit, and I hope you can hang in there. It's going to be awful. We're going to do some things that you just wouldn't ever think we could do or get done. You're going to be so thirsty, you're going to feel like you're in the Sahara Desert, and I'm going to give you a thimble full of water about every 2 hours. It's going to be terrible. Are you going to quit on me? No, sir. I'm a winner. He said, let me tell you something else, Marcus. We're not going to win while you're here, while you're in high school.
We ended up with the team, I think, that maybe won a game through default from Mariana long ago. We were taken as a group to a school outside of Memphis, Tennessee, which was nationally ranked, and promptly got beat 99-0. That was my first opportunity to play on the field, because everybody else was hurt or lame, and it was fourth quarter, and Coach Wright had kind of given up on having much success that night.
He took that bunch of young boys, and he said, I'll tell you what I'll do. Y'all hire me, which I said, that's up to the school board now, it's up to the AD. He said, and I guarantee you, you'll either have a championship or play for a championship in 3 years.
We worked out 51 weeks a year. In the summer we worked, I was a lineman, we worked out in the afternoons. And we'd get in the weight room that was unair conditioned. It was kind of a long and narrow room. We'd get in there, they'd keep all the windows shut. We did about the first half of our workout with all the windows shut, and it would get so steamy in there, you really couldn't see from one side of the room to the other.
They were hard. Even though they were optional, you didn't miss. If you missed, you would pay for it.
It was hot, compounded by being in locker rooms that had no air and no water and, 50 guys lifting weights, trying to suck all the oxygen up they could. It was quite different from what most anybody else would know as high school football.
Back in those days, quite a bit of summer jobs was maybe going to field, chopping cotton or something like that. And basically, most of those time, we went to work and came and worked out.
And do our morning workouts, and then we would we would put our clothes in our locker that we wore that day. Remember the half shirts and the shorts and the jock strap, and it was just soaking wet. And you just put it back on then that afternoon for the second two-a-day, still wet, still stinky, and put them back on again and get the pads back on and such.
Blytheville not only was hot as Hades and humid being in the Mississippi River Delta, but I mean, and it was hot around there everywhere. But then you start getting into the weight room and you close up all the windows. You get into the little green room there and you close up all those windows, and you know, they basically had boards. So it blocked out all the lights. There was no airflow in there. And I mean, man, it was like the ceiling was dripping.
If it could have rained indoors, then it would have rained indoors in there, for sure. Hot and humid, they didn't want to open anything back then. They didn't want to give you a lot of water to drink. And a lot of things have been learned since then, different. But back then it was old school and it was an experience, it was.
And I was over this morning looking at the old weight room, and it's amazing how small that place was and how much we got done when we were in that place. I was telling the guy that was showing me around this morning, I said, you know, this place looked a little bigger now that I'm in here, but I can remember those windows being closed when we entered, and when we left there, there was probably about an inch of water on the floor.
Somebody would sneak over and open a window up. Well, he would come in there and he'd see that window open and he'd just go nuts. He said, we ain't having no windows open. He said, and I mean, it'd be 150 in there and we're in there lifting weights.
Every time, even today, every time I think about it being hot outside in the summertime, it never gets too hot.
Within 45 minutes, time we got ready to leave that place, you could hardly see each other because of the fog. Everybody else was sweating and you got all this heat going around, and the walls was dripping wet with just condensation.
We used to have Edgar Castillo, who is no longer with us, but Edgar used to go out and do a dance, a rain dance, trying to get thunderstorms to blow in over the field.
We were always looking at the weather report the day before to see how hot it was gonna be, and not just the heat, it's the humidity and the sun. The greatest practice days were the days where we had pouring rain. We'd love to go out and practice in the rain and roll around in the mud. At least nobody was going to get overheated on those days.
In August in Blytheville, it's 95 with 90% humidity. And back in those days, coaches would not give us any water.
Coach Wright did give us some water every now and then.
I can remember a specific instance where one of the guys on our team, Vansell Lucas, I can remember Vansell, I looked over at him and he's over in the corner there, and I kept noticing he was trying to get closer to the mud puddles, and looked over there. Next thing I know, he was over there trying to drink water out of the mud puddles.
All he could do is just confirm it.
doing that after that rainstorm, I tell you.
But the funny part about it was we were all so thirsty. Usually, I mean, we were even trying to drink the sweat out of our jerseys.
We very, very seldom ever took our helmets off, whether it was in practice or games.
And we would just eat salt tablets by the handfuls.
And a salt tablet, that's right.
The salt tablets.
Back then, we had a big gallon jug of salt tablets that everybody would eat like they were tasting like vitamin C. Or orange, and they just get a handful and just eat them like candy.
You know, back now you watch your salt intake. Then it was a handful,
I guess it did us some good. I'm still around. I don't know.
And I'm surprised nobody died of heat exhaustion, but we didn't. And I think because we were so well conditioned.
Oh, it was hot. He turned up about 100, about 110, 15 degrees in there.
I can distinctly remember that when you got through lifting weights, you had to run sprints on the practice field, and then you walked up to the stadium. And I quickly discovered that there was no water break in between sprints and bleachers.
Oh, bleachers, it was always five sets of five. And you run up and back was one. And you run up as fast as you can, run down as fast as you can. Now, if you slip coming down, you're liable to fall out into the other bleachers below you.
One day, running those bleachers, by the grace of God, I'm glad Ozzy was standing there, because I was coming down fast and I couldn't stop, and my head hit his knee, and with pads on, and I was like, "Thank you, Jesus!" Instead of hitting the rails, and I'm laughing now.
So I used to actually bring a mason jar full of ice water and hide it in the weeds to the entrance ramp of the stadium. So one day I'm walking to my water, and Hollifield and Bracey, you know, they came and they saw that I was drinking water out of this mason jar, and they were crowding around and grabbing my mason jar, drinking, trying to, you know, they were fighting over the water. And the coaches never found out about it. I think Coach Ross was the guy in charge of the morning sessions. He never found out about it, and he never caught on to the fact that sometimes I would run the bleachers and I started throwing up this huge amount of water out of my system. Like, where did I get all this water in my system between the field and the bleachers? They were kind of jealous of my innovation.
Our running was a lot like it was in the off season. We did a lot of 10-yard sprints, 40-yard sprints, 60-yard sprints, 100s. We did cross countries, and during the early days, we wore weight belts.
We used to meet at the gym, and we would run to Walker Park, and we had these weight belts and weight vests and all this stuff we wore.
We'd have to wear weight belts around our waist. That was interesting. Not many people did that.
The guys used to cut them and take all the lead out of them and put cotton in them. Steve Stumbaugh was really good at that. He always made sure that he had one that probably, I think the only thing weight it had in it was the vinyl of the belt itself. It looked real because he packed it with cotton, but he cut every bit of the drain the lead out of it.
It's Blytheville, Arkansas in summertime. That says enough because of the heat and the humidity. And we work out inside of a gym that didn't have an air conditioner. So that tells you how it was in Blytheville, Arkansas at that time.
Well, you did not go on vacation if you played football at Blytheville High School. So there's no, the word optional does not exist.
I can remember even as a freshman in junior high walking past the gym at times, and I could hear them in the middle of summer, the pads clapping together, and I knew something was going on.
Dancing was our code word for our practices in June or July, and you're not supposed to start until mid-August. And having been a football coach myself for 17 years, I get a big kick out of this. But anyway, so Coach Wright would have on the chalkboard there the word dancing up there, that we're going to be dancing today at such and such time. And I'm going into my sophomore year, and we finished working out in the morning. It's about, I don't know, 12:30 or 1 o'clock now. We're waiting for the linemen to come out. We're going to start the dancing, the hitting and pads. And so Dennis Davis, affectionately known as Runt, is sitting next to me. And I'm going, "Runt, what are you doing here?" He goes, "Man, I'm going to do some dancing." I said, "Dancing? You think we're doing dancing?"
Football Association was looking at us. In fact, when we did our half-line scrimmages back in the dance, we actually had, and I was one of them one time because I was hurt, we had a player that would sit out in front of the gymnasium with a walkie-talkie.
You know, of course, we had lookouts. There was a coach outside with a walkie-talkie that he would say red alert if somebody was coming.
And you yelled fire, fire, fire if you saw a car that you didn't recognize roll up.
You know, it didn't make any difference whether the athletic director or basketball coach or whatever. But you have a red alert.
Well, we did it, but that was confidential.
Dancing, who could forget dancing? Oh my gosh, we'd back in this little room back here, we would board it up, bolt it down, put on the pads, and start a little bit
ahead of everyone else. Maybe at the 1st of June.
More practice you get, the better you are. Hey, and the old saying that they say, of course, in Alabama, if you ain't cheating, you ain't trying.
And I don't imagine we were the only people that did that. You know, I imagine that went on in a lot of places.
Oh yeah, we called it dancing. It was a slick way of saying that we were dancing. Of course, that's how I learned. That's where I learned how to base one-on-one block, and I used it throughout my career. It's right in there with Coach McGee and Dave Lewers and Bill Ross and Larry Wright, and we spent some. Man, there were some hard times in there, but they were good for us.
Sprints, and like we did, we ran day and night, morning and evening. Now, trust me what I tell you. Sunday, Saturday, Sundays too, we had to come up here, but a lot of people didn't know all that.
It was hot in there. And you can only do half a line, you know, and stuff like that. I mean, that was tough in there. I mean, we went against each other all the time. And
junior year, we started dancing because I started working out with the linemen. But And the only reason I did that because I was afforded the opportunity for that time because Tom Sylvester and I had summer jobs. The summer jobs we had involved painting Barney Crook's house, a neighbor across the street, her fence. We painted stuff. And Tom also got me this job of stacking hay for the Delahunties. And that field was located right in front of the runway where the B-52s would fly right over us, and it swear it was like it was 100 feet above us. But the very first day that we had that job, I couldn't see with all the hay in my eyes. It's just incredible. So we would go that afternoon and we would dance. And I wasn't used to dancing, although Kidd and Spaeth and company were dancing the year before. And I remember my first session, I went there, we were all dressed out, it was 3-on-3, and I thought this was so cool that I'm going up against, you know, Briley. You know, I said, man, he was all everything in 73, and I'm getting to play against him.
And I know once we had a false alarm, and I was thankful for it because it was burning up inside. But we get our pads off real quiet, get our pads off, walked out the back door, and it was good to get out of that night. You know, it was something we had. And people used to ask us all the time, why are you so skin up, or why you got burns, carpet burns? Well, fell off a bicycle or something. I don't know, we just come up with some kind of lie, you know.
We knew there was something wrong going on because there was a lot of secrecy and a lot of people outside watching. We sort of didn't like it, but we were sort of excited about it because it was something new and different. We were kind of going against the establishment, sort of breaking the law.
It would be 100 degrees outside, and we would close all the doors and all the windows up. And there'd be 35 people in there, and it would be 150 degrees or...
Oh, it wasn't all hot. If you were in a pressure cooker, it was real cool, but it was a pretty nice place to be, especially in June in the summertime with the windows all shut up.
You know, we want to be the best we can be. And anything you want to do, you want to be the best you can be.
We were all young. We didn't know any better. We thought that this was what everyone did. And then when we got away from it, we realized, oh my God, nobody does this.
Steam, smoke coming off your body. And Coach Lewis said, y'all be careful. And it's not because I don't want y'all to get hurt. I just don't want any blood on my bars.
And we didn't know any better, so we showed up and did it.
That was something most guys wouldn't do it back then, you know, in the summer and off season, working, wrestling and working out, you know, we really did. We did it to the full extent.
Who knows what goes on behind closed doors? Only us, you know.
Just to take a little advantage to kind of get a legs up on our competition and try to do the best we could with the situation that we were put in.
And leverage was something that we always had on other people. We weren't very big. I think Coach Wright stated one time in the paper, well, we're not very big, but we're not very fast either. But we still intend to win a lot of football games.
The football in Blible back then was a year-round deal. And we might not have been outside, but we were practicing football. And we'd be back there in the locker room. And I know statute of limitations now, I can go ahead and say all this stuff, I think. But, you know, we would read it and then go out and just pitch it into the wall. You know, and I mean, and then before we left, we'd get on all fours and he'd say hut and we'd butt heads. I mean, people don't believe it, you know, when you tell them, but it actually happened.
And then if somebody got close, we watch a cotton bowl film. Broke out of a big box, turn that cotton bowl film on, and somebody would let them in. What are y'all doing in here? Oh, we're watching the cotton bowl film.
Some behind closed doors, some in other towns.
And when that went enough for him, we loaded up the school buses at night and we drove out to
Burdett
a few times under car lights, working on the fields and staying till the moon rose.
It was tough. We, especially the ones when we went out to Burdett. We went to Burdett and he ran off half the team that year.
Two-a-days, what can I say? August 14th every year, a twinge would come through my spine just to know where I was going to be and how long I was going to be. And actually, at the very beginning, there were three-a-days.
Sometimes there were three-a-days. I can remember just getting up early in the morning, and you know what I remember, and I remember to this day, if I walk out in the summertime, freshly mown grass, it takes me back to two-a-days.
At 5:45, we show up on the field by 6.
They were really grueling.
Two-a-days seemed like it was just one whole day.
Under Larry Wright and Coach Lures, those days was something that you kept you up at night, just thinking about going into them.
I started dreading two-a-days about April.
First two-a-days we went through, it was like all we heard was horror stories. How tough it was going to be, how crazy we were doing it. You know, and I can remember Bobby Hossel, when, you know, we were in ninth grade, he was in 10th grade. He went through two-a-days, completed it, and it was such a feather in his cap, he quit. And we couldn't understand. You just went through the worst part of the season and you're quitting? We didn't understand that.
When you look back, it was good on everybody that was a part of it, whether you finished or whether you didn't finish. I think looking back and even today that young men need to go through this type of thing. Maybe not as I don't want to say brutal, but tough.
Yeah, I remember Briley, you know, Gary Briley, he would say, you know, he sets his alarm and tries to wake up at 3 so he can go back to sleep and make it last longer.
But I can remember going to two-a-days, first at the practice session in pads. And Coach Wright, my first scrimmage, I had to go up against Bubba Sane. And Bubba was the tackle, and I was this little skinny 165-pound guard, didn't know what the hell I was doing. We thought we were badasses in ninth grade, and we were, but not in the 10th grade.
Terry Newman, and Terry lived in Yarborough with us. That it was during two-a-days, if you will, summer hot, and we were so tired. I think we'd practice in the morning. Came home, had lunch at my house, I believe, or Terry's, I can't remember.
The last thing in the world we really wanted to do was go back to practice. I mean, we knew it was going to be hell on earth. And so anyways, we're if I remember the story right, I do remember what was said, but we were stopped at a stoplight.
And then we were in Terry's car, and we were driving, and we came to a stoplight, and Terry was so tired, he said, "Do y'all want to have a wreck?"
If we just hit this car over here and have a wreck, and they'd have to call the police, and we wouldn't have to go back to practice for the afternoon. I mean, that's how desperate we were to not have to practice, but
to get out of going to practice.
But it didn't turn out. We didn't have a wreck. We went back to hell.
Starting in the morning around about 7-8 o'clock. And then we have a lunch break, and then we come back by 1 o'clock and enjoy ourselves by another hard day of practice and a very hard day of lifting weights. At the end, Coach Wright told us, "Hey, you're getting bigger, you're getting stronger," and we all remember they're going to be on the fourth quarter, that it all pay out for us.
I saw great athletes that tried to come into the program, certainly much better than me and certainly much better than some of the people that I thought were outstanding athletes. They couldn't do it for whatever reason. Mentally, they just did not have it. If you weren't a mentally strong person, you were going to be broken.
I never want to go back to that again. The amount of sweating, dying of thirst, never passed out, but I know there were times when we would do anything for a drink of water or to get in the shade.
You really enjoyed it when it was over with. I guess that's the best way to do it.
we'd get back, have time to eat lunch and come back and do it all again.
You would try to go home and take a nap between the afternoon and or morning and afternoon practice. Most of us would cramp up so bad because we were so dehydrated that you couldn't sleep. So you went back to the field house and you begged for a salt tablet, which is a terrible thing to have, but and then you just rolled right into the afternoon practice, and then you went home, you went to sleep, you got up and did it again. It was just the way life was.
43 years later, when I hear those church bells at the Methodist church ringing at 5 o'clock, I'm always thinking back to 1973, and I say, well, we've got about half the practice over with by now.
All you could think about is, when can I lay my head down? You were just wore out and thirsty all the time and never got a drop to drink. And if you got something for your thirst, it was a salt tablet.
My sophomore year, that was his first year, and we actually had a lot of good athletes. They just didn't have a full year of Wright. You know, they couldn't get in shape. They wasn't in shape the way they should have been, you know. And, you know, Joe T. Robinson was quarterback back in them days, and we had really some really good athletes. And I think we won one game, you know. And the next year, we were supposed to be really good, and it didn't pan out that way. And we won two games.
When I came in as my sophomore year in high school, we didn't have a great season, but we didn't have a lot of seniors at that time. But we had more juniors and sophomores that came in. And we won only two games that year.
The third year, everything kind of came together.
He took guys that probably wouldn't have played anywhere else. I mean, you got Charlie Partlow.
I used to look at Partlow and I said, well, he can't see that very well. But Partlow gave me, if you ever seen back some of the touchdown break runs I got, it was because of he did that. He come across and blocked linebackers. And I was saying, man, that's a great, great block.
You know, Charlie was legally blind. And he made him into a great center. I mean, great, great center.
Couldn't play any specialty positions because I couldn't see very well. I mean, they put me on the line because I was close enough to the guys I had to block that I wasn't going to miss them. We were the first to go 10-0. From the previous years where we were conventional losers, it was really kind of unusual because we started winning our games. And we realized early on that we were definitely better than the teams we were playing.
Blytheville football had gone through, I guess, a couple of decades of just basically winless seasons. And there was a dearth of wins. I mean, much less a winning season. And my first year as a sophomore, we won three games. And my second year is when we had the great team. And Coach Wright put together a great team, basically with some average athletes, you know, a sprinkling of some good athletes, and then one great athlete in Bruce Hay.
I remember we played Jonesburg, you know, and there'd be like 10 of us over on sidelines when they was on the field, and Jonesburg would have like 100 over there.
When we played Jonesboro our senior year in 73, we hadn't beat Jonesboro in 10 years. And we came out, our seniors were lined up and all their guys were lined up, you know. And of course their guys were big. You know, I was one of the biggest guys on the team, 6'1", 195, you know. I mean, we had a few, it was over 200 and something, but. And Edgar was standing beside me and he was, he was threatening me, he said, we're gonna kick y'all butt. You know, but of course he said the other thing and he was shouting, we're gonna kick y'all. And I just looked over Edgar, and I said, Edgar, I said, I wish you wouldn't do that. Don't get them riled up, you know. And I swear, I think on the kickoff, Edgar went down the field, and I don't think Jonesboro thought he was going to, you know, a little guy, he wouldn't do that, and he went down the field and made the tackle and set the tone for the game.
And we just beat the dog out of them. I think Gary broke one of them's neck over there.
We were really well coached in the area of preparation, physical, mental.
And then Marty Orr hit somebody, I think, from Jonesboro on a punt, and I mean, about killed him. I mean, it was... They knew how to hit. Coach Wright knew, and he taught them boys and how to hit.
The leader of our team, Bruce Hay, was a phenomenal athlete. He could do most anything with a football. As a quarterback, he was probably one of the best ones in the state of Arkansas. You know, the rest of us at that time, if you were 200 pounds, you were a monster. And we had a team of 160, 170 pound kids that were out there. And that was on a good day. Most of us were probably not even breaking 170. And you had Willie Taylor, you had a few of the guys that were bigger. But, you know, none of us, we were all muscle. There was no fat.
I always was impressed by Edgar. I mean, I wished I'd have had, you know, I played just to play, you know, you guys want me to play, but Edgar had the heart that I wished I'd have had. I believe I could have done things, but, you know, that's just the way he was.
But Gary Bradley would give you your heart. Tank Harper would give you your heart.
Well, 1973 was a good year for us, because during all that time, all the hard work and sweat, we became 10-0. And if it had not been for that, we would probably still have been 1-9. So with that said, we was pretty good. I think we was a pretty good team.
Willie Chiller Taylor would give you your heart.
We had the 1,500 pound club. Remember that? Where you work out, you had three lifts to do. When you made that, you had made it.
It's probably the one of the highlights of my life. Just that one year that little time period in the, you know, early 70s.
We went down and beat Forest City in a driving rainstorm where they'd beaten us by 60 points the year before. And we beat them on a last second field goal by Bruce Hay. And we really kind of thought we might have a special season then. Then about halfway through the season, we realized that it became sort of unusual for us to expect anybody to beat us.
We didn't have a lot of depth. You know, we had some talent, but we were not all huge.
And Wright taught us in that, hey, no matter what happens, we in this together.
We went to Sylvan Hills one time, and we were 9-0, and they ran a hook and lateral. And Bob, they hooked it, and then they lateraled it back, and the guy was gone for a touchdown. If he gets a touchdown, we lose the game. And he ran the guy down from behind and saved the game for us.
Sylvan Hills. I got on the field, I never got off. Offense, defense, kickoff, turn, punt, return. And I was middle linebacker with Wally Smith. And this guy, they did like a reverse or something. The guy went around their right end. And I kept noticing our guys were missing tackles like crazy. So I knew, you know, I knew this guy had speed. So I knew I had to take an angle. And I just took off to where I only way. And I mean, Coach Wright said I always was a good runner when I got nervous and everything. And so I took off, and I got to him, I just pushed him. And he went out of bounds like 7 or 8 times. And Scott Alley come up and you saved the game, you saved it. And I got mad at Scott. I said, well, y'all should have tackled him around the end. I shouldn't have had to done that. And after the game, I was walking off the field. That little guy was behind me with one of his teammates, and he said, who in the world caught me? He said, I didn't think they had anybody fast enough to catch me. And I just smiled and walked off the field, never said anything, but I enjoyed that, you know. But
that was a pretty big play there.
He taught us fundamentals. He taught us to tackle and block and to tackle hard. And I think that's how we won.
You know, Mac Williams, you know, he couldn't have played nowhere else. I mean, he didn't weigh 160 pounds.
The undefeated season was just amazing. The whole town, I've never seen Haley Field packed since or before when I was a young kid going to high school football games. It was like a small college town. There were that many people wanting to see, you know, the Chickasaws play ball. It was truly the epitome of a small town. It was awesome.
We won with kids that, you know, everybody else probably would have given up on.
Let me tell you what happened to Saxton. He went to Saxton to a basketball game with his family. I wasn't there, but I got in afterwards. And when he got, and I want you to remember one thing, and you're talking to me, but there are a lot of people involved in this thing that need to be recognized. They were good people. I wasn't the only one. We had a bunch of good people. We worked to pay for that, to pay for those trials too. Remember that right there. But we made up mind we're gonna go with him. He was the most intent man I ever saw in my life.
Win it again.
I'll tell you what.
We had a basketball game up there.
He went up to the basketball game, took his family up.
Larry pulled up to left, let his wife and kids out.
This is what I hear now. He pulled up in front of the place, he let his family out, the police said you can't do it, so he got into to a set to with the police.
This policeman came up and told him to get out of there, that they could go park somewhere else.
Move this car. Hey, officer, there are children in the back seat. Shut up!
He said, I'm not parking, I'm letting the kids out. He says, I told y'all to go now.
And you, move this car.
Well, they put him in jail. I got a telephone call. He's in jail at Saxton. I said.
So he came out of that car, naturally, and that's the way it all started.
What are you in for?
I beat up a cop.
Nice.
He tore the policeman's shirt. I imagine he grabbed his shirt collar. And I don't know all the details there, but I went down jail to get him out. He said, I'm not leaving. He said, I'm going to stay here.
I need a game fume.
And so Jack Holmes was there with me. And I said, Larry, I tell you what, I'm just going home, leave you here then.
We luckily got a lawyer and got him out of jail, and he was charged with some pretty good assault, everything. So at any rate, I don't know where he's right or wrong, but he thought he was right. So, we started making deals, and we talked him up and said, okay, if you'll pay for the uniforms of the policemen.
If you'll buy the policemen a new shirt.
They'll drop the charge.
I'm not buying shirts in a witch thing.
He said, hell no, I'm not gonna pay for the uniforms. So at any rate, that's Larry for you now. I don't know whatever happened, he didn't pay for the uniforms, and I tell you what, he got out of it too. So that's the way it went.
Coach Wright had nicknames for everybody. My nickname was Nub, which I didn't like and I don't like to this day.
Sam Macri in here, and he was called Pinhead.
I was named Pinhead, and I looked at him and I said, why? And he said, because at that time I had an extended neck with a face on it.
When you weigh 150 pounds and 6'2", and promptly inadequately named Stick was my nickname throughout the season.
Pumpkinhead.
Steve Briles, he called Pumpkinhead.
Oh, he called me Milk Toast. He called me Lucy.
Right, Coach Wright called me Pissant on many occasions.
But Rodney Curry, he called Boo, because he said he wouldn't run away from his own shadow.
It was so many, Bogey, you know.
Basically, everybody had some, most of us anyway.
Honky with Bruce.
Jacob Alley, we called him Elwood. Well, that's his dad's name, Elwood. We
called Jacob Shark. Gary Holmes was Tally.
Coach Wright just said I was so sweet that my mama either made me hot cocoa or cupcakes for breakfast. And he started off calling me cocoa, but then finally went to cupcake, and it just kind of stuck from there until the junior year when I had a paralyzed arm for a year and a half. And it was between cupcake and dead arm, but most people know me as cupcake.
And Eddie Tucker, he called Ignorant Eddie.
Ernest Bogart, robot, because he slid over the ground.
He robot. Every time I used to run, he used to say, robot.
And we called Jimmy Anderson Zeke. I don't know, I think he called him that because he couldn't remember his name for some reason.
Rosemary's Baby.
Darryl Hollifield with Bucky Beaver. With Bucky.
Bucky Beaver?
Bucky Beaver.
Well, Brad Coulter was Seaweed.
Seaweed.
And we called John Kid because he just acted like a big old kid.
I had the worst, I think I was Kid and Spook.
They called me Truck because I was running over everything.
Special Ed.
Ed Spade, we call him the Tope.
Runt.
You know, we call him Dip because of the way he practiced.
I didn't think you remember that.
He called Rocky Long, he called him Penguin. And
I remember that very vividly because Rocky kind of ran, I guess, like a penguin, I guess.
He called me Rat because I ate a bucket of popcorn. I put a whole stick of butter in there. Ate this butter popcorn a day before practice, and I'm throwing up like crazy when I told Coach Wright what I did. He said I ate some poison corn. So Brad was Seaweed, I was Rat. John Mackay, he was Tater.
Tater?
All kinds of nicknames, but.
Because he ate like 19 tater logs out of 20 one time. Joey Gumby was Mudcat. And Jimmy Kirkendall was Zero. Coach Smith gave him that name.
Zero.
Jimmy Kirkendall, they call him Zero because I figured he didn't do anything.
Zero.
Jelly Willie.
Pinion, David Pinion was called Bun.
And Tank. You know, because I'm Harvey.
You know, sometimes I can't remember a kid's name, so I think that's the reason why we have so many nicknames. It's not because he just decided that I'm going to call this guy this. I think that he looked at it and said, I can't remember this kid's name. I'm going to call him a name. And it's stuck with you throughout those years.
And they have it today, actually. I mean, most of the guys, if you see them, that's the first thing you think of.
But, you know, we had guys that were, you know, all different walks in of life, social backgrounds, and everybody meshed, you know, and it worked. And, you know, everybody had each other's back.
I think Coach Wright and people like my class and the class before me, the class after me, we learned to get along. We could talk about our race and not get all uptight about it.
It would be such a atmosphere of closed-inness, but that it came out to be a point of enjoyment as well, because you came to build a relationship. You know, it's just like someone being confined together.
We were all black, white, yellow, red. We were all brothers.
We really seemed like a team of friends. Guys that now had spats, almost like a family where you had fat spats. You get mad at each other. You even fought sometimes. But still, everybody, even today, everybody feels some sense of closeness.
There was this bond that existed, and maybe it was we're all in this together, or the world's out to get us. I'm not sure, but it was. It was us against the world, essentially.
Everybody was treated the exact same, no matter where they came from, who their parents were, or anything. And it was as though we were all one.
When I see different players now, and I might not see them for a while or something like that, but most of the time, we don't shake hands, we hug each other.
We felt one another, all of us was emotional with one another. We was one big happy family. Everybody got along good with one another.
And it wasn't anything about black and white. I mean, hey, he worked your ass off, and he worked your ass off just like he worked that other guy's ass off. And so you all know what's, everybody was the same.
Runt, he was my brother because he was the only guy that was remotely as small as me. And I think he and I had a lot of the same qualities.
We came together. We picked at each other. We gave each other names.
He, luckily for him, had come from a football family. His older brother Don was an all-state running back.
We was family. You know, I came through just as the school was integrating. And so, right, I had a chance to really talk to him and see him. He even picked me up some morning from me trying to catch a bus to bring me on to school. So, right, did a lot for me and for everybody. But he did not play the game that I'm gonna play this guy first, I'm gonna play this guy first. He always said one thing, if you was good, you was gonna play.
His brother Randy was quite accomplished running back the year before. So he had something to live up to, you know.
We didn't become a good team playing football, but we did become a family of teammates.
There was an environment, an atmosphere there that just created a mutual respect between all of us.
To this day, to know, you know, my wife, she goes, you know, it's amazing to me that you still are in touch with the guys you played football with 40 years ago, and you stayed in touch with them for that long. And I go, I think that speaks volumes to, you know, what we went through.
I don't get back home to Arkansas that often, but the few times I've been back, when I see my buddies. You'd think most people, when they haven't seen their good friends in a long time, it's, you know, how's your wife doing? How's your kids? Well, we get to that. But the first thing we always say is, hey, do you remember when Coach Wright did this? Do you remember that when Coach Wright did this? You remember this happened this time? It's all Coach Wright stories. My wife couldn't believe it. But we'll go on and go on and go on about Coach Wright stories, and we'll finally get to how's your kids doing, how's job, and things like that.
And he used to run the scout offense. He was quarterback. And he would run, actually, no pads. He would run over everybody.
He blamed quarterback, it seems like, for the entire 2-a-days of August. Without a pad one on, full speed.
At first, I used to think, well, I don't want to hurt him, but he started hurting us.
It was not unusual for him to maybe step in on defense and let himself be hit.
Hit me if you can. And they hit him.
Marty contained him really well and kind of just grabbed him. And Coach Wright said, you don't ever do that playing football. Hit when you do. We're going to do it again. So they did it again, and Marty kind of hit him a little bit, and Coach Wright says, I mean hit someone. We're going to do it again. So Coach Wright came around the end, and Marty put his face right in his chest, drove through him, put Coach Wright on his back.
They hit him, and he got up and went again every day. I could not believe it.
Coach Wright just popped up and hit him on the head and said, now that's how you hit.
First year went on, second year he's doing the same thing. And the third year, when our group of seniors, we'd had enough of this, and he ran a couple times, and Briley and a few others on defense, they lowered the boom on him pretty hard, busted his chin. And I remember he had a beautiful Seiko watch, green, and I thought it was the prettiest watch I ever saw. And he broke that into millions of pieces, you know, and he said, that's why you tackle.
One of the coaches, Coach Lewis, looks upside my head, and I'm bleeding. Well, he just takes something and wipes that blood off and said, put a Band-Aid on there. You'll be all right. Be ready for the next play. Okay. After the ball game, they come looking for me because here I got about an inch and a half cut deep into my cheek there. Well, Dr. Cole at that time was a doctor that traveled with the team. After the ball game, they looked for me and put me up on the stage where we were dressing at in the gym, up on a tennis badminton table or something. Anyway, he did surgery and put 4 stitches in my cheek that night.
You know, Dr. Hard was the school doctor, or athletic doctor, before he left. And then when he left, I called Coach Mayo and volunteered, because about that time I had quit doing OB. As long as I was doing OB, I was tied down. I couldn't do too much else. And so that's how it all came about.
And I'm still walking around there thinking, I got a scratch on my face. And then they realized and shared with me that I had to take 4 stitches that night. And, you know, he was a great doctor because I never did notice the scratch anymore.
On Sunday afternoons after the game, the previous Friday, we would go over to Coach Wright's house to watch game films. And Coach Wright would always be yelling that we're just grabbing and scratching.
Grabbing and scratching.
We're grabbing and scratching. You're not hitting. And then we'd watch the next play. And
that film running. And, you know, Coach Wright had that reverse button. And all of a sudden, somebody grabbed a running back quarterback by the shirt and spun him around. And Coach Wright hit that reverse button. Let it go. He said, grabbing and scratching. Whee! And he hit that button again, and it went back, and he goes, whee! And he hit it again, whee! He says, we tackle. That's a we tackle.
He'd say, you're grabbing and scratching. Well, in the middle of this, one of his daughters came in, and he said, and the daughter said, just crying, Daddy, Daddy, Courtney just hit me. And he looked up and he said, well, thank goodness that someone in this town will hit someone else.
Coach Wright was an avid film. He's a very big studier of film. And I can remember being critiqued by him and Coach Lewis in the film room. And I can remember one day making the fatal mistake of saying, when Coach Lewis, I believe, said, well, Jumper, you missed the block, you know, you missed your block. And I made the fatal mistake of saying, but Coach, he wasn't where he was supposed to be. And that did not go over that well. And Coach Lures kind of said, "Jumper, well, the next time you go over and grab him by the face mask and whisper in his little helmet hole to stay still where you can block him." And it was funny, but it's also a life lesson, because I thought, you know what? When I get out in life, they're not going to stay still for me. I'm going to have to do what I need to do to make the block, and there's not going to be any room for any excuses in life, and you're not going to be able to whisper in somebody's helmet hole in the business world to stay still so I can do what I need to do. So it was a good lesson for me.
Coach Wright taught us to be like a rubber band cock, like a snake. You ever seen a snake reach out and touch you? You could reach out and touch a person without even coming out your stance, because you get forward. You move forward like this. You reach out, you're still in your stance, feet down, hands down, but you're moving forward. And McGee and Lewis made sure you did it, because they put you on that bar. They made us stay low. I hated that bar. I hate that bar now. When I see one, I'd be wanting to just melt it down, because it hurt the back of your butt. If you was up too high, it hurt back here. If you was up really too high, it hurt up here. So think about it. We didn't know at the time they was training us to be weapons. And when we hit you, remember, all of us had big necks. Look at us. All us got big. You can tell who played ball. All us have big necks. Not now, we older.
I remember one time I got in so much trouble because I was late for a 2 o'clock weightlifting program, because me and my mom went to go go get some catalpa worms so we could go brim fishing the next day.
Well, in the off season, we would wrestle, and I would usually wrestle one of the guys kind of about my size, Mac Williams or one of those guys, and I'd always beat him because I wrestled when I lived in Wyoming, and I knew how to put people in holds, and I'd wrestle. Now, well, Coach Wright decided that he'd put Tank against me.
And Steve Woodson, yeah.
The rest of this story is just what people tell me, because I waked up sitting against the wall. So apparently, I went and grabbed Tank. Tank picked me up, literally turned me over, dropped me on my head. I got up and said, "You ain't doing that again." And he did it again, and then I woke up sitting next to the wall, went to the doctor, spent a day or two in the hospital for a concussion.
Well, I've got this football helmet I started to bring with me today. It's when I played sophomore. My sophomore helmet's got a big old crack on the back. And I was really the tackling dummy of the team. I was going to bring that today, but I didn't. But Gary Briley, he used to just wear me out, because I was, you know, like I said, I was a young guy and they were the old guys. And I took my beatings from him, and Gary and Coach Wright made a man out of me, Gary Briley. They were hard on me, but I survived it.
I mean, everything was full speed. You start agilities, you're going to get lathered up, then you go into form. We called it form butt tackling, but it wasn't really form butt tackling. It was full speed, head-on bore butt tackling. And that's the way we learned the game. That's the way they taught the game.
And Gary would just, as Coach Wright would say, he's going to knock your socks off. Gary would knock your socks off.
My only competition was Gary Briley. Now, he was the strongest man at that time. See, I was a junior, he was a senior. Him and Bob Hall, and they always put us together. And Coach McGee, he used to, because, you know, he was a big puff, man. He had me wrestling him and all that stuff, me, Gary Hall, and Bob Hall. See, us three were the strongest men on the team.
Between him and Bob Hall, some of the greatest things I remember, I don't care how far I ran, I come back to the huddle. Bob Hall would look at us like we just, like, went 2 yards.
Oh, that's, I've never been one for really the heat. And boy, I mean, they called me Hung Dog, and they called me Moon Man, because they said I looked like a guy looked up the moon, or said that look I had on my face. And Larry Wright asked me, he said, "How come you play so well on Friday nights? But during practice, you don't do, you know?" I said, "Well, have you ever noticed we practice during the heat, the sun?" I said, "Friday nights, there's no sun?" I said, "There's a big difference."
When Coach Wright and all the coaches would bring all the players over to the pregame to the Dixie Pig, and I think it was roast beef and mashed potatoes, green beans, half a peach and stuff, and we were bringing the waitresses and my mother were helping bring the food in, and I think it was Coach Wright's first year, and Coach Wright couldn't remember my mother's name, and he hollered across the room, he needed something, and he said, "Hey, Elvis." And she didn't really understand that he was talking to her. He said, "Hey, Elvis." And she turned around, and it kind of went through her a little bit, and she walked over there and she said, "Let me get something straight. My name is Wanda Hossel,
it's not Elvis. And he said, yes, ma'am.
He was like a little animal. He'd get back there with me in the secondary when we would be doing scrimmages, and he'd say, Hollifield, get ready, Hollifield. He's getting ready to make the option. Get him. And he'd stick me on him, and I'd just go as hard as I could. If he told me to run through that wall, I'm going to run through that wall as hard as I could run.
Now, this isn't a football story, but it's a story about a football player, Dana Mullins. I remember that we were in English class, and one of the assignments was to write poems. And so I think we each had to write 3 poems. And so the day that we were going to turn them in, everyone was saying, well, let me see what you wrote. So I got Dana's, and it said Fog by Dana Mullins. Fog comes on little cat's feet. And I just started laughing, and Dana says, what are you laughing? I go, Dana, that's really a really famous poem. He goes, really? I go, yeah. I said, I even know that. He said, do you think the teacher would know it? I go, Dana, if I know it, the teacher has to know it. That was written by Carl Sandburg. I only know like 3 poems in the world, and that's one of them. So he didn't turn that in.
Steve was the only person in high school that could actually throw up on command. And he did it several times to get out of a run, but that's another story.
There were some of us that were really strong, naturally strong. And then there were some of us that weren't. I said, I don't think Tom and I were naturally strong. If we benched 260, we were lucky. I think Ed was even worse. He was at 240, you know. And I just remember John Williams would always make fun of Ed because John was putting up 320. And he was trying to impress upon Ed that he was stronger. And Ed goes, I don't care how strong you are, I can still kick your ass. You and Rosemary, Rosemary's baby.
We had guys that were, you know, just physical specimens that, you know, you look at them as a high school player and you said, oh my God, these guys were, you know, bench pressing close to 400 pounds. You know, you look at a guy, John McCahey's size, he was as fast as I was in the 40-yard dash.
The guys that was in that era of Larry Wright will all tell you that we was in a fraternity. Now it was a fraternity that did not have a name. And we was all Chickasaws. And he did put us, because just didn't anybody have an opportunity to play for Larry Wright. Now, it was some incidents where Larry Wright ran some people off. Just to see what you come back to beat you up, to see what you come back and say, hey, I want to play. Not my dad want me to play, my mom wanted me to play.
Mostly I didn't know. But once while I was about to quit the team, and Coach Wright said, if you're going to quit something, you quit it as a man. You come out there on the field and quit. Don't do it behind closed doors. Do it in front of everybody. And I went out the next day, he said, just do it one more time. If you want to still quit, I'll let you go and go. And, you know, that gave me more confidence. And then the next day, when I went through it again, you know, it didn't bother me and stuff. I didn't want to quit. I wanted to keep on going and stuff. You know, like I said, he gave me a lot more now I appreciate him for, because he taught me how to be a man.
So I remember our sophomore year, we're playing Marianna, Arkansas, and it's halftime, and this big storm comes up. It's lightning and raining. The referees come into the locker room and go, Coach, excuse us, the Marianna wants to know if you want to postpone the game. I thought Coach Wright was going to blow a gasket. What are you talking about? And we all of us players just went nuts, like, you know, no way we're, you know, lightning, who's worried about lightning?
But we had a guy named Riddick. And Riddick was an old country guy from, and I guess he was an offensive wide out. And so during the plays, the wide outs would have to be a certain amount out. Another play, they may have to be 10 feet farther out. And he could never get it right. And I remember Coach Wright finally said, all right, Riddick, for this play, you need to be 10 rows out. Talking about the cotton fields. You need to be 10 rows out. For this one, you need to be 5 rows out. And man, Riddick was right on the dime when he told him that.
He always gave me a tough time about singing in the choir. Now, I kind of thought he had the hots for Miss Shilin, to be honest with you. That was a choir director. But he tells me, no, no way. But anyway, when he heard that I had was in the choir, then he started giving me a hard time about missing practice at certain times when I'd have concerts. And so eventually I got him to come to one of those concerts, and needless to say, he pretty much enjoyed it. But it was funny because eventually we had an opportunity, and I'd never really been in a play before. So they asked me to try out for a musical called Little Mary Sunshine. And you can imagine how that would go with Coach Wright, hearing about you being in a play called Little Mary Sunshine. So I go to try out to be in it. You know, I didn't want to be the lead part by any means. So I go try out, and then they had published who was selected to be in the play. So I got the lead part. So needless to say, I didn't want the lead part, you know, because I knew it would require a lot of time, a lot of memorization, and I didn't have time with football and all. So a friend of mine, Terry Newman, he was also a vocalist, and he tried out too. So I said, Terry, do me a favor, you take that lead part, because if I get that lead part, Coach Wright's going to kill, he's going to be giving me all kind of grief.
From what I understand about Bucky, kind of afraid of what Coach Wright might say, you know, he wasn't alone in that deal, because to be on the football team at Blyville, you were the men of men, and to be in Little Mary Sunshine.
So Terry took the lead part, and I did the backup. I was a force ranger for Little Mary Sunshine. But Coach Wright, he always gave me a tough time about having to take time away to go on these choir trips and do that. But Coach, just so you know, I'm still singing to this day.
You know, and I was always confused about how talented that 75 senior team was. It seemed like the entire team could bench 300. They had the fastest guys. There was nobody faster than Jacob Alley or Gary Holmes.
I can remember it like it was yesterday. It was a hot summer two-a-day practice scrimmage. I think it was being filmed, and he was coming across the middle, and for some reason, I was going the other way, and here he come at me, and I just made the perfect tackle. I can remember it like it was yesterday. It was one of the perfect tackles I ever made. It was like they taught me how to tackle, and I was reminded about it when I came in the door today.
Since I did have kind of a small head, they didn't make helmets that were that small unless they were a custom-made helmet, and there were a few times where a helmet was hit, and it was turned sideways, and I could look out the ear hole.
I mean, they were running 4.4, 4.5 40s with pads on.
Tell people, hey, I guarantee you, our high school program is the toughest in the nation. Oh, yeah, sure, everybody's was. No, you don't believe the stuff we did. Our typical Monday as a sophomore would be this. 5 o'clock in the morning, Ed Spaeth lived behind me. Me and Spaeth would be out in the front yard waiting, and Coach Smith would pick us up, drive us to school. He'd have the country music going on, drive us nuts. Now I love country music. Anyway, he drives to school, so we'd start lifting from 5:30, while it's dark, 5:30 to before school starts. We got to lift and run before school starts. We put in a two-hour workout before school starts. Now it's sixth period, our practice. We had a game that night, doesn't matter. We have to practice. We go through all the practice from 2:30 to 5:30. At 5:30, they get ready to do conditioning. Okay, great. They keep us from doing conditioning, but we've done a three-hour practice in the afternoon, two-hour practice in the morning. Now they set us down our full pads along the building. They go to Burger Bowl, get us some burgers and milk. We eat some burgers and drink some milk. Then we go play a football game after practicing 2 hours in the morning before school, 3 hours after practice, and then play a football game. But again, you know, I look back and you know, if you can go through that, you can go through anything. So I have nothing but gratitude toward Coach Wright.
And you had Marty Orr, the only four-year starter for the Chickasaws.
You know, I was able, one of the few guys that had an opportunity to come over in the ninth grade years of junior high at that time to come over and work out with the senior high team. The numbers were so small that Wright went to both junior highs and would pick the bigger kids and have them to come out and work out with the kids.
He was playing as a freshman my brother's senior year in 72, and he played with me his senior year in 75. So that's 4 years of Letterman. So we had Marty, and then we had Ozzie Riley and Bubba Sane, and you know, we just had this incredible. And then you had Hollifield, who was super fast.
When I first came to Blyville High, I was probably one of the weakest guys there was. And so Coach Wright would challenge me and trying to make me better, and as only he could do by trying to break you down. And he called me every name in the book, tried to make me better. And I took the opportunity that what he gave me to improve myself, but not only that, to get stronger and to prove him wrong.
Hey, I was scared of the guy. You know, he wasn't a friendly, warm, kind of huggy, kind of teddy bear guy like maybe he was later on in his career. You stayed away from him. And you didn't want to be the brunt of any of his criticism on film day. And I know there were some film days where I wanted to not even go in. I wanted to hide.
So we get in the meeting room, one of those health rooms up at the front of the gymnasium. And so, boy, we're all sitting there, half of us asleep, waiting on Coach Wright to come in because we're going to have a little chalk talk before we go out. He's going to put the conditioning on the board and everything. And so Green's sitting there in front of me, and I mean, we weren't talking very much and stuff. And all of a sudden, Coach Wright said something, and, you know, I think it was supposed to be funny, but we were just, you know, dreading that heat and that practice, so there wasn't anybody laughing about anything. And then he said something else that I guess he thought was funny, and Green, I saw Green kind of reach down beside his desk, and I kind of looking at him strange, and he had this little box, and it was a laughing box, and it was battery operated, and that thing started laughing, and it laughed and laughed, and Coach Wright, his eyes got as big as saucers, and everybody else's did too, and they're looking around, and Green slides that thing under my desk, and it's coming from under my desk, and I'm stomping on it with my cleats, trying to break it and everything. That thing's in a million pieces, and it's still just laughing and laughing and laughing.
Our gene pool, our athletic gene pool, was not that great, but Coach Wright got the best out of us, you know, and we were strong. I mean, I remember my freshman year in college, joined a fraternity. We went to go work out in a gym, and I just threw some weight on, and it was just maybe 260 pounds a bench. And people were from Fayetteville, the Bulldogs were there, and people that were freshmen that I played against, and they were just in awe. They couldn't believe how much weight I could lift. And from my freshman year on, no one ever messed with me, you know, because of Coach Wright.
And then we would always listen to this one album, and one thing that we will always remember is "Send Amici at Me."
Send Amici at me. 70,000 people looking at us, 1 yard away from something. And Johnny sent him there, and Chuck got him back for a 3-yard loss. And when the four downs were over, instead of that ball crossing that 1-yard stripe, it rested on a 6-yard line. Gentlemen, 1 yard from the winning of the game. 1 yard from the Big Ten Championship. 1 yard from the Rose Bowl Championship. 1 yard from success or failure. 1 yard from distinction or nothing. And in the game of life that you play, that could be, well, 1 inch. Or not turning the right corner. Or not having the guts to open the right door.
Junior high, we came out of two winning junior high programs, the East and the West. And we had speed, we had size, you know, we had the knowledge of what the offense and defense was, who was running. We had been in it for ever since eighth grade. And so we were that team that was supposed to repeat. And
great opportunity to go to state, great opportunity to win out.
We had an incident that happened with a kid passing on the field.
Before the season even started, we lost Donnie Reeves out on the field.
We were at off a different section of the field, and I didn't see him fall or anything to that nature. And so we were kind of kept out of it, which is the smart thing to do. You don't want a whole bunch of people running around. But I remember the ambulance coming and taking him away, and then sometime later, after that, you know, we find out that he had passed away, and they came and told us that he had like an aneurysm or a blood clot or some sort of situation that was completely, could have been in his head for years that just happened to be triggered at that time.
A lot of kids left the team and everything, and I would not be telling the truth if I said I didn't think about it myself, but when you put the kind of effort and you've done the kind of things that you've been coached to do for years, it was hard for me to do that and leave.
When we were on the bus going to the funeral, Coach Wright stood and told us that there are going to be some difficult days. There are going to be things that you may hear, but one thing you know is that you can always call me and talk to me about these things. And that's the part that really touched me, that what Coach Wright did is to let us know that he's not hiding anything. He just wants us to understand and know that he will be there in the midst of all this trouble.
It was one of those times when you first learned what misfortune was at our ages. Because, you know, we worked hard and we went through a lot physically on the field, but this took a lot mentally out of us. And a coach like Coach Wright and the coaching staff he had really helped us get through that and kind of guided us through, because we wasn't ready for that.
And we ended up with four seniors on that football team.
We started out as, at that time, I think we had about 35 players on the team. By the time we finished, we were down to 19 players.
Some people questioned whether they wanted to play football again after that.
And out of the 19 players, there was Ozzie Riley, Scott Mosley, Cupcake, or Charles Weather, and myself, what were the only four seniors of that year.
There could be some sadness, there could be some tough, maybe emotional times, but at the same time, it allowed me to kind of rise above and maybe have other people look to me and how to be strong during those difficult times.
The town itself was always, I think Coach Wright's always had problems here in Blytheville, Arkansas, but I think the people that played for him understood what he was trying to build, what he was doing and how he was trying to turn us into young men. Not just athletes, but young men.
Got into the season and injuries started happening.
Tom Sylvester, first guy out, knee surgery.
Tom tore his knee up.
After he had gotten out there in the hell of the game, got his knee tore up.
And I said, "What's wrong?" He said, "My knee." I looked and it was rolling around, a mass of just tissue swollen. Unfortunately, wasn't the last guy out. We had three more. Edwin Spade.
Suffered a lot of injury.
John McKay.
And John got his knee tore up right at halftime.
Brian Wright.
Next game, I tore my knee.
That all required knee surgery, and they were all integral parts of that team, so really set us back. We had some people that mid-season quit.
JB had quit during his junior year after they lost to Helena. They had the infamous belly flop, a Labor Day weekend. They're flopping like crazy, and there were several people that quit.
Quite a few of the juniors, seniors, quit mid-season, as well as some of the juniors.
People started dropping out.
I look back at what Coach Wright had as a coach now too, and what Coach Wright had. We were down to 20 players. You had all the, half the starters injured out with knees.
I got hurt. All the key players were hurt.
And who could imagine a 4A team playing a season with 17, 19 healthy bodies?
He had a no-win situation there.
Just ended up with barely 20-something players when we were rolling out to play teams that some of them suited 120 players out. And it was hard, I didn't come off the field my junior year, not a single play. I played offense, defense, and all special teams.
Something that was meant to be, and I believe each and every one of us took something from there. It made us all stronger.
I think probably after every game, I was either at the doctor's office or at the hospital almost after every game from injuries myself. But Dr. Cole, knew him not only as a team doctor, but as Rick's father. Very soft-spoken man.
I'd get Rick up at 5:30 in the morning, take him to the gym, and it was good for him.
Still have kept in touch with him over the years. Susie lives down my way in Florida.
So I went and got JB the very day after football season junior year, and me and JB drove over to Coach Wright's house on a Sunday, told him we wanted to come back out for football.
Events that happened through the season, mainly with injuries, that turned the tables on it. And then of course that then turned the community at that point.
And it just, looking back, it just frustrates me so much he didn't get a senior year, because had he had us as seniors, guys that we'd had since sophomore year, I feel like, we made it to state when Coach Wright wasn't there. But I feel like had we had Coach Wright there, we would have won state.
After he left, it really hurt me.
When you're a kid, you don't know what to do. But looking back, hindsight's 2020, I just wish there's some way we could have talked to the school board or the townspeople or whatever and got Coach Wright there our senior year, because again, what we had, we really felt like we could have gone undefeated also, like you know, Bruce Hayes junior year, Rocky Long senior year, like the 73 Chicks, and so that's what we really miss.
I was very disappointed. I was mad. I was angry. And knowing that he the one that put this team together, built us, strengthened us, made us mentally and physically tough, to take that away from him.
We should have, as a class, boycotted or did something to keep Coach Wright there.
But knowing that Coach Wright, a man of great values, ethics, morals, and those types of things, that wanted no more than us to be winners.
But we somehow managed to survive it and keep that team unity and went to the next year with a wonderful team.
And what we did was took from what he gave us, and with all his coaches and staff, the will to win. And that was no one gonna stop us, and we're gonna show everyone that how we gonna win and what we need to do. Even though he may be gone, but he is still here. In the spirit, you see it in us when we walk, how we talk or carry ourselves.
Coach Wright, without a doubt, we would have been state champions our senior year. We won the conference, and right now, Runt Davis is giving you this plaque. It says, Coach Larry Wright, this belongs to you. With sincere gratitude, the 1977 Chickasaws. Thank you, Coach Wright.
You felt like always when I played for Coach Wright that I was part of a special group of people, and not everybody could do that. Not everybody could do what we did. In fact, my year that I played for him was only about 19 of us that could do what he did, what he asked us to do. And so I carry that with me in everything I do in life. Everything I do, every job I've had, I use that as perspective and use that as, you know what, if I can do that, then there's no limitation to what I can do if I work hard enough at it.
Having a goal set for yourself, you know, and you know, it just gave, it built my momentum up to become the man.
It's always been in part of me where I know that sometimes things get tough, but you can weather the storm and you can get tough too. That's basically what I took from high school football, and that's what I try to teach my kids, is just that life lesson that Things get tough, and you can get tough yourself, and you can weather those storms if you just have the mental fortitude.
Throughout your life, you try to reach that same level again, but you can't because it doesn't exist.
I tell stories about Coach Wright right now. You know, I coached a Misco football team for 13 years, you know, and we won 3 city championships. We were runner-up at least 6 times, you know, and I practiced my guys kind of like Coach Wright practiced us, but not to that extreme. And Coach Wright, he's a legend amongst us guys.
Coach Wright brought to my attention equality.
Living out in the country, didn't have a way to get here. He helped me with not only with my education, but helped me get to be the person I was to get to go to college, because without an athletic scholarship, I don't see myself going to college. Wright is an individual who is one of the most respected men I've ever been around.
Coach Wright really, I could see how he really wanted to make them feel wanted and accommodate them and to do certain things for them.
He come to the house, talked to our parents, got us involved, and told them, I'm gonna make sure that they get there to this program. But he come to our house and talked to the mom and daddy first and asked them and got a chance to meet them, got acquainted with them. And he won them over. And so I told him, we had to come. We didn't have no other choice. We had to come see them.
And I can remember on the way back from football trips, we would stop by and drop Thomas Johnson off in Burdette before we came home. So he really tried to go out of his way. And he was always talking about just how, you know, the African-Americans, how injustice it was for some of their opportunities, and really tried to balance the scale.
Wright could take a boy and make a man out of him real quick. And I think that's why you see his son is doing so well. or in Memphis, Major's doing so well, because he's able to mold men. He can make a child and mold him into a man, but yet he was gentle enough to have a compassion as well. You know, you look out throughout the Bible, God always talked about compassion for your fellow man. And you know, everything you see that is about compassion, love, grace, and mercy. Wright, you could characterize Wright with some of those same characteristics because he had compassion for you. He might work you to death, but he had compassion for you as a person. And he had love for you as a human being. And he would bend over backwards for his players and for the people who were there for him, even people who wasn't there for him. You know, he did not turn his back on nobody.
Summer before my sophomore year, we were over at Jerry Lynn's when it was over by the railroad tracks. And I was in there one morning, in fact, Coach Ross was teaching the class, we were taking driver's ed. And we went in there to get us some breakfast, get us some donuts before we went over to the driver's ed class. And Coach Wright was in there, and he said, Leggett, you gonna play football? And I said, no, I don't know. Oh yeah, you gonna play. You get out there Monday, we're gonna start Monday, or whatever it was. He said, come on, you gonna be out there. So I did, and there it was. I played and stayed as long as I could, and of course I was injured, and I didn't finish my senior year. But it carried me on, and I got a degree and finished with athletics at Ole Miss for 4 years, continued on and got a master's degree, and then got into coaching business, and I've been in the coaching business for 35 years. So that one moment of him telling me, yeah, you're gonna play, just about formed the rest of my life. Football's been a part of my life now for nearly 40 years.
He had a close bond with my mother and father. He had been out to the house several times. And I think he knew what he wasn't gonna do to me, she did it, so.
So on a personal note, there are very few people that make a big impact on one's life and stay with you. And Coach Wright is definitely one of those people. Brings a tear of joy to my eye.
I was the first one in my family to go off to college. Other parents that was connected with us would hug us, invite us to their house, yard parties, picnics and things like that, and travel on the ball game. And one of my worst experiences is when I was in Kansas. Like I say, most people would have probably gave up, depressed or whatever. But after those ball games, and we've been lost or won, and walk off the field, and being a guy from Arkansas, being in Kansas, small school, walk off, and nobody would walk up and call you by your first name. They said, hey, 75, good ball game. And when you used to be in here at this, here at Bob High, where everybody got involved, the parents of other parents, kids, and things like that, that really, we was a family. We were a family, and the color did not have a problem with it.
Subconsciously, you don't think about things that he impacted for you, but like, I figure this, as far as I'm concerned, he's about as rich a guy as I know, because he's touched so many lives in so many ways. And when the good Lord decides to take him, I think he will say, well done, you know.
Me even considering playing football at the next level, where I did go to college and play football, and what football did is kind of drove me through school in order to get a degree. And Wright was a big part of me being able to get to college and be able to get a degree, and not just to further educate yourself. It enhances your life.
Coach Wright was just like a daddy to us. And man, we come here to practice. He have to make us what we are. And when we went on that field, and he said, I want y'all in that kind of past the rest of y'all life. Y'all gonna get it. You gonna get it. You gonna go to the assignment. You gonna stay out here. And he said, I'm gonna make men out of y'all. And he done just that.
This was harder than this in 1973. This was a lot harder than anything that comes your way now.
No, I hadn't found nothing else better, because you know he gave me the tools for me to be able to cope with anything and stuff. You know, Coach Wright gave me them tools to do it with. You know, don't just let anything defeat you. You defeat it.
As I look back at through my career, anything I've done, I've always compared it back to my high school days. nothing can ever really challenge me like Coach Wright's program did. I'm very thankful for that. It's been a blessing for me and my family.
I used to call Coach Wright a number of times during that era in Kansas because I felt I was a Lone Ranger traveling through a land of total stranger, being at a school and in a new state that didn't know much about. Only thing I knew about Kansas was Dorothy and the Wizard of Oz, you know, that show. So even the grasshoppers seemed like they was 4 inches long from watching those old sci-fi movies where they would come in and take over the crops and things. So I'm leery of everything goes on out there. So I did a lot of calling home and talking to my parents. Don't get me wrong, I had a good relationship with my parents and everything, but Larry Wright, I could ask him almost anything. And he was the first man that ever told me at the age of 20 years old. And I said, Coach, I'm on the phone now. And he said, or when was the last time you had a cry? I said, Coach, I'm a football player and I don't cry. You didn't told us that. He said, I'm telling you now, go and lock yourself, go run your roommate off, go and lock yourself in a closet somewhere, grab your pillar, stick your head in between that pillar and give a loud shout, cry. And it was something that took a lot of emotion and things off my shoulders. Being a long way from home, couldn't see my mom and dad. And you know, he was that type of guy that you could call a friend. And like I say, he, a lot of the issues and the things that I went through in life, just like the job I have at Nucor, Yamato Steel, it was those jobs and working out in Kansas and going and playing at Arkansas State and those kind of things, it ended up kind of being easy because of the I guess most people could call it stress level, but the competition level that he gave us to work hard. And you know, it didn't matter if you was going to be a sweet streaker or whatever, you did your best you could.
Coach Wright spent as much time preparing us and getting us ready as we were doing ourselves, so I respected him very much for that. He basically abandoned his family during season, and they were along for the ride. However, the football team was number one in his life, and he was number one in ours.
He taught me perseverance, never give up, never quit, you know, no excuses. You know, I think the same thing that he taught just about everybody, mental toughness.
We had a lot of kids that were living in houses over in the south part of town that they didn't have floors in their house or something like that. They were really struggling. And on Sunday morning, these places would find a big sack of food on their front porch and so forth. And of course, the guy doing that was Larry Wright himself, because he had a heart for people. And I guess it's kind of hard for someone that was not in the program to see that he had everyone's best interest at heart. He was just a tough taskmaster, and he wanted the kids to be the best they could be.
Where I lived at, he would come and get me. So I spent more time with him than anybody did, me and my brother, because he would come out to Burdett, where I grew up at, because we didn't have a football program out there, and I came to Blava High, and he would come and get me. Then when we left two-day practice, I went to house with him. So that's why I got my rest in between practice. So my day was from 7 o'clock in the morning until whenever he decided to take us home.
It was a number of black kids that was playing that did not have that father at home back in those days. And so they didn't have a direction. And yes, he did. He went out and probably paid some fines from young guys for getting in trouble and getting them back in school and things like that in those years, to just to get them in a position where they had some respect and somebody that cared and loved them.
And Coach Smith and Coach Lewis would all take turns, but in the summer months, it was always Coach Wright.
If you have come through this program in your day,
you're a different person. Your outlook on work, your outlook on family, your outlook on improving yourself all the time is different. I noticed it when I got into the workforce. I noticed, hey, these people don't have the work ethic that I have. You know, these people aren't trying to get better every day at what they're doing. You know, I had guys even joke with me working for a government, you know, that, hey, you know, you're getting paid the same as the next guy regardless. I go, I don't do anything for what I get paid. That's how I've been raised, you know, to be the best person I can be. And I think a lot of that attributes back to the program we were in and building yourself up, you know, and doing things that even you thought you couldn't do and accomplishing things that you never thought you would accomplish.
Coach Wright, you know, you, when you work, you got to work towards something.
He would do anything for you. If you showed him that you would work, he would, you know, he took Ed Spaeth down to Memphis, Tennessee to get his knee operated on. Like I say, he called coaches for me for college football. He, you know, I've heard he took groceries to other kids' houses that didn't need groceries or a jacket. So Coach Wright just, you know, he would do anything for you if you showed him that you cared.
His leadership, his mentor, his values, ethics, morals, which he had instilled not only in me, he instilled in everyone, the will to win.
He was a hell of a man. Still is a hell of a man, I'm sure. You know, he was a madman. He was crazy. I hated him, but I loved him. The great thing he taught us was preparation and hard work cure a lot of ills. You know, we were average athletes, other than maybe the Bruce Hayes and Ozzie Riley's. The rest of us were just average. And with enough hard work and enough preparation, you could excel. And that was the biggest thing Larry Wright taught me.
Coach Wright, I love you, man. You've always been in my thoughts and prayers. I have great respect for you. I'm honored to have been a part of it. Thank you very much.
Coach Wright probably did for me, like everybody, I think, had been in his realm, you know. Taught you words are commitment and dedication and where you can go. Like being at the top of that mountain, you know, we've been there. I know what it takes to get there. I'm not there now, of course, anymore, but through my life, I know that there's nothing I'll ever do that is physically or mentally tough is what he put us through.
I know that's one of the things that helped me get along later in life because of the self-discipline that I learned.
Nothing is given to you, nothing is easy. If you don't work for it, you'll do something else. I thank you for that. And I thank all the coaches for helping me reach that goal. And now, I can smile and say, I worked hard to get it. It's mine. I owe nobody anything. But a thank you all for helping me get there.
So I'm not eating. Coach Wright comes back there to me and goes, what's wrong with you? And I said, well, Coach, I can't eat this roast beef. He said, why can't you eat the roast beef? I said, I eat roast beef 3 times a week, Coach. I said, if I eat it, I'm done for. And he said, what do you want? Real quietly, he said, what do you want? I said, well, I'd really like to have cheeseburger, fries, and a Dr. Pepper. And he went to Buddy Hossley, he said, get Briley a cheeseburger, Dr. Pepper, and French fries. But that's how in tune he was, you know, to us and our needs and just small things. But it wasn't just me. I mean, he knew every one of those guys. He knew them inside out. And Coach McGee, Coach Lewis, all the coaches, Coach Ross, you know, all of them did.
I also learned from Coach Wright, just you got to watch people. You got to look at people. Sometimes they're hurting. Sometimes you got to be able to pick up some things in the cloud of confusion.
I can remember it was a very difficult day, very hot one day, and I was playing. My twin brother was playing too, and we were worn out.
I had every reason to not be feeling right. You know, it was hot. We were physically fatigued. We were mentally fatigued.
Coach Wright noticed that we weren't doing very well, and he asked, what was wrong, Aiken? He talked to my brother.
And Coach Wright looked at me and said, Aiken, what time did you get in bed last night?
And he said, well, we had some trauma in our family last night.
I didn't sleep at all last night. And the reason was we were having some major domestic issues at home. And somehow Coach Wright picked that up. He was able to look at me and pick that up. You know, it could easily be written off as, you know, carrying the pack, it was hot, we're tired, but he saw something. He saw that I wasn't quite right, and he knew. in the cloud of the confusion, the heat, heat of battle, and the physical stress we're going through, he could pick up something else that wasn't quite right.
From nowhere, Coach Wright came up to me and he put his arms around me. He said he was sorry about what happened.
How would he know that? How would he know to say, Aiken, what time did you get in bed last night?
That night, after the summer practice, we got a phone call at our home, and it was Coach Wright. Spoke in a temperament less like Dr. Phil and more like Donald Trump, and said that he wants Gordon and Charles to have 3 meals a day, and he wants them to go to bed at 9 o'clock every night. And so that's what I remember about him. So he was a man, he was tough, but he loved us. And I learned a lot from him. And I learned that things in life are not taught as much as they are caught. And when you're Coach Wright, you'll catch a lot of things of wisdom. And I remember, and I love him very much.
Well, I'm gonna say this here. He wasn't discriminated, whether he's black or white, he gonna say the same thing, you or me or whatever. And that's the way he was. I mean, he did a lot of cussing. He had me cussing a lot, but I overcame all that, praise the Lord. But he, that's the way, that was his mentality back then. A lot of people didn't like the way he did it, but he's the best coach.
I appreciate so much in the effort that you put forth to us, and just love you for it.
So I went on and played football at you know, a different level, but I didn't face a tougher conditioning program or a facility from anybody other than Larry Wright's program. I mean, if you went through that, you could face and do anything. And that's the truth. In life, if you could go through that, you could conquer the world.
You're just gonna play. I'm not playing who anybody tell me, and that's why I love the man, that's why I love this coaching staff, and believe me.
Hey, you've meant a lot to me, and you've meant a lot to other people, and you got a lot to be proud of, and I just wanna thank you.
You know, my mother and father raised us the best they house, that they knew how. Sharecroppers down in Burdett, Arkansas. And basically, I wanted a life better for my kids, my stepchildren, the stepson, and the 4 nephews that I raised. And by instilling in them what he instilled in me, they become successful men in their life. And one of the nephews is an anesthesiologist in Birmingham, Alabama. And one is a head maintenance operator in a food factory in Gainesville, Florida. And they all doing really good. And they're raising their kids, they're good daddies to their kids, they're father figures to their kids. And a lot of this was instilled by Coach Wright.
The will to win is something he always instilled in us. Whatever it takes to win, whatever you got to do, you can win.
No matter what cards you're dealt, you know, you always have the outcome within your own grasp. As tough and as hard as he was, it was the best thing for my life. And like all of us guys, if you ask any of these guys from Blyville, I guarantee you they'll tell you, if you can go through what he put you through in off season and 2-a-days and that, you feel like you can go through anything. Life's easy.
And that's what Coach Wright instilled in us. You don't wake up to say you're a loser. You wake up to say, today is a new day and I am gonna win.
The America's air crews were busy practicing their skills.
We're launching 2 A6s and we're gonna just go out and practice our high altitude bombing. And we don't get a chance to do that very often from high altitude, so it's very important that we do that as much as possible.
We came back from a mission and I was the last airplane to recover. And one of the two systems on the aircraft failed after I landed. And then the failure I had is not only took the brakes away, but took the nose wheel steering away. So as the airplane continued forward up the angled deck, I couldn't stop, I couldn't turn, and it actually rolled off the angled deck. And so we ejected, both the bombardier navigator and myself ejected, and we landed. Both of us came down on the flight deck. I had a broken ankle. My bombardier navigator didn't really break anything, so he was actually flying again in a couple weeks. I think the mental toughness and the failure, the inability to accept failure, the inability to accept mediocrity from his standpoint, it leads you through the rest of your life.
It's been nearly 40 years since I went through what Coach Wright put us through. And again, being a high school coach now, being a teacher for 30 years, Coach, I can honestly say this. Most important thing in my life, Coach, is being a Christian. My relationship with Christ is the most important thing in my life. Christ is my number one influence in my life. After that, my second biggest influence was my dad. And Coach Wright, after that, my third big influence was you. I love you, Coach Wright. I can't say enough about what you've done for me. I thank you so much, and I just hope that you love this film and know how much your players love you. And again, I can only dream what it had been like to have you our senior year. Coach Wright, I love you.
Whether it's a trainer or a football player, whatever, you know, you just do your best. And so, and that's all. That's what I learned from him. And I learned from him that everything in life has a price. If you want to do well, it'll have a price. There's a cost to it. So that's what I learned from him. And I said before, I love him. I respect him.
One day I got a phone call, and they said C.C. Delaney, who was a principal at the high school, had had an accident. A car pulled out and hit him. And that they were afraid he wasn't going to live because it looked like this blood clot was going to pass through his heart. And so I got Larry and told him about it. And he said, let's go out there. And I told him I had something to do, but I'd be there shortly. And he went out there. And so I went out, and I was in the waiting room. Of course, we couldn't get in to see him, anything like that. We realized that. And as I went in, there was Larry over in the corner. Tears were in his eyes, and he was sobbing and so forth. And that's the kind of guy he was. You know, a lot of people thought Larry was mean or tough, but he had a heart. And he had a heart for all the players. He worked them hard because he wanted them to succeed.
Coach Wright, I would like to tell you thank you for what you have done for me in my life back then to where I am now. Is all because of what you have taught, what you have given, and what we have as a team worked together. And I would always remember that this jersey that I have is because I have talked to your wife, Miss Wright, and she allowed you to give me this jersey. And I will forever, forever hold on to this jersey because it means a whole lot to me that you allow me to wear this jersey, and I represent Blauer as well as the man who taught me what it takes to be in this business for the strength and the courage to carry on, and you will always be number one for me.
I truly believe people dream about things that they're passionate about. I still dream about football. You know, I dream about getting out on that field one more time. And I hope I do till the day I die.
Joined the military in 79. So basic training was a breeze for me. I mean, I just went through it with no problem. The drill sergeant was amazed. I was honor graduate out of basic training. Later on in my career, I was selected by the Army to be a drill sergeant. And one thing I did not want to do was embarrass Coach Wright or any of his staff. And so the things that he had taught me as a young athlete, I carried it with me through drill sergeant school and when I was a drill sergeant. One, I became that, I also was selected, or my platoon was selected as honor graduates for the whole year that I was a drill sergeant. Coach Wright, I have always loved the man.
Coach, I want to thank you for everything that you've done for me. My life right now is because of some of the things that you've taught me. You know, we've had this conversation before, and I told you, I said, I married a redhead because you married the one. I named my youngest son Major after your son. And I just wanted you to know that your influence on my life has been wonderful, it's been great, and I appreciate everything you've done for me.
My father passed away when I was going into 10th grade, and Coach Wright was a very prominent figure, you know, as far as leadership and, you know, direction that kept me going during the high school years. I was very appreciative of it.
Coach, you changed my life. When I was in the 9th grade, I grew up in an abusive situation with my father, and I didn't have any male role models. I had no self-confidence, and you looked at my 9th grade films, and you talked to me, and you said, I want you to play football for me. And I said, why, Coach? He said, because you're a winner. And when he said that, it changed my life. It really did. I had somebody, a male role model, believing in me, and it helped me to believe in myself, and it changed my life.
It'd be the best time of your life. At the time, I didn't think it, you know, running doing the workouts, but at the time after I got out, I look back now and talking to the guys in the lobby, it was the greatest time, best time of our lives.
I got married right after school to the girl I'd been dating since ninth grade. Everybody knew her, and my wife passed away in August, and she was a good woman. She was the toughest woman I ever had, multiple sclerosis, and never complained about nothing. She held on long, but even the last day, she told me she loved me and smiled, and that was it. But, you know, I'm like, I was lucky to have her in my life, and Larry Wright, you know, his personality was a lot like my wife's. You know, they pushed me and kept me going through, you know. I mean, he taught me a lot of that stuff, you know, and when my wife was going through her situation, I think what I went through with us on the team, it helped me. So, because I had a lot of people, why don't you leave her? Why don't you, you know, I loved the woman. I mean, she did more for me. I mean, when we first married, you know, she was the grown up, I was a kid, and, you know, she was always taking care of me. And I think that's basically what needs to, just don't give up. I mean, you're gonna have bad days, but keep going, you know, you're gonna have good days too. Just don't let things get you down, and that's what I've learned, you know.
Coach Wright, you don't know the impact that you had on my life. When I met you when I was 16, I had no idea that it was gonna be a journey like it was. You changed my life by giving me a couple of chances, second chances, and I took those chances. You took those chances on me, and it gave me the opportunity to play collegiate ball, and it got me a free education, as well as some of the other players. I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart. Thanks.
Been a lot of years since we played for you. And cannot tell you how much you meant to me down through the years, how many times I've thought about you. I believe with all my heart that you wanted the best for us, and you did everything in your power to make that happen, because you not only wanted a winning team, but you wanted people who would win throughout their life. And you dedicated yourself to that. And me, along with all these other guys, we want to say a thank you 1,000 times over for what you invested in our life. And the time that you decided to come to Blytheville, Arkansas to coach football, we cannot tell you how much we thank you for what you did for us, through us, and in us, because it's lived on. And we want to say we thank you very much. And you know, we love you, bud. We really do, because you remain in our hearts and you remain in our minds throughout our years.
Ladies and gentlemen, Darryl Hollifield.
Thank you, Coach Wright.
It's those showers from above that make the river flow.
Thank you, Coach Wright.
I'm gonna face the storm head on. Though it drives me to my knees, that's where I'm.
Thank you, Coach Wright.
Ready for the rain.
Thank you, Coach Wright.
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 Thank you, Coach Wright. Thank you, Coach Wright. It's those showers from
above that make the river flow. Thank you, Coach Wright. Gonna face a storm head on.
Though it drives me to my knees, that's where I'm made strong. Thank you, Coach Wright. I'm ready for the rain.
Thank you, Coach Wright.
Thank you, Coach Wright.
Thank you, Coach Wright. Thank you, Coach Wright. Ready for a chance to go.
It's those showers from above. Thank you, Coach Wright. Make the river flow. I'm ready for the rain.
Gonna face the storm head on. Though it drives me. Thank you, Coach Wright. That's where I'm
made strong. Thank you, Coach Wright.
Thank you, Coach Wright. Even if those showers fall,
you're still all above it all. Thank you, Coach Wright. For the grace that gets me
through. Thank you, Coach Wright.
Thanks, Coach Wright.
Thank you, Coach Wright. It's those showers from above to make the
river flow. Ready for the rain. Thank you, Coach Wright.
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 Thank you, Coach Wright.